Alice Crimmins. Alice Crimmins leaves an uneasy feeling in the mind. She was convicted of killing her 4-year-old daughter Missy and 5-year-old son Eddie. She consistently denied the charge and sought retrials with varying success, or you might say with varying failure, since her final and operative retrial resulted in her drawing a longer sentence than would have been the case if she'd accepted her first conviction. The murders happened in the New York borough of Queens in 1965. On the morning of the 14th of July, police were summoned to a ground floor apartment in Kew Gardens. There, 29-year-old Edmund Crimmins, a tough, beer-drinking aircraft mechanic, told them that his kids had vanished overnight. He was estranged from Alice, who kept the children in the Kew Gardens apartment. On July the 13th, she'd given Missy and Eddie a supper of veal at 7:30 and put them to bed. Sometime after midnight, when she went to bed herself, she'd looked in at their bedrooms and they were fast asleep. As she went back to her own bed, she fastened the hook and eyelash outside the children's bedroom door, which stopped little Eddie from wandering out at night. According to Alice, he tended to raid the refrigerator. At 9 a.m. she went in to get them up and they were gone. The bedroom window was open, so it seemed that they had been abducted. Alice telephoned Edmund, who came round at once, and called the police. That afternoon, they found Missy's body. It was half a mile away in a vacant lot. Her pyjama top was knotted tightly round her throat. Alice was brought out to identify her. She fell back into a detective's arms and passed out. But she didn't cry. Now, this seemed very suspicious to the members of New York's finest handling the case. They expected bereaved mothers to wail and sob. Many of them, of course, were of Italian or Irish extraction, and the stiff upper lip was no part of their family culture. And as a good Catholic copper, Detective Jerry Peering, in charge of the investigation, had already decided that Alice was not his ideal of a good woman. She was 26 years old. She was sexy and she knew it. Her hair was perfectly dyed and permed. She wore toreador pants. In Peering's explicit opinion, she was a bitch. Questioning seemed to support this conclusion. It was the middle of the swinging 60s, and Alice swung hard and fast. Her promiscuity had caused the rift between herself and Edmund. He simply couldn't take the constant infidelities her nature compelled. Of course, unfaithful wives weren't a novelty of the period. But unfaithful wives who saw nothing to be ashamed of in their own sexual needs were extremely disconcerting to the macho and the conservative and the boys in blue. Alice Crimmins evinced no guilt, no blushing confusion when questioned about her extramarital bedroom activities. She admitted them, and she saw them as completely irrelevant to the necessary inquiry into the disappearance of her children. The police were not pleased. They concluded that the hook and eye outside the kids' bedroom door was not intended to safeguard the refrigerator. It was to stop either Eddie or Missy from coming in and catching Mommy in bed with a different man every night. This seemed to them reprehensible, though they would probably have moved to have any children taken into care if they ever came across mothers who did not object to being discovered in flagrante by their toddlers. A week later, Eddie's body was discovered. It, too, was abandoned in wasteland. But after a week in the July sun of New York, it was impossible to decide how the child had died. The tragedy caused a temporary reconciliation between Alice and Edmund. He moved back into the ground floor apartment with her. But this happy state of affairs was short-lived. Alice still needed other lovers, and once tempted to ask her who could blame her. For in his own admission, Edmund was a flasher who exposed himself to children in the park. I'm not a psychologist or a sex therapist, so I don't know for certain, but I'd have thought that a man with that degree of squalid sexual disorientation was likely to be a pretty unsatisfactory lover. And Edmund's conduct on finding that Alice was still promiscuous is equally unimpressive. He hid in the basement and listened to her making love to another man. He bugged the bedroom and collected tapes of her performance with a range of lovers. He had plenty of material to hand over to the police when their doubts about Alice hardened into solid suspicion of her. The suspicion came about when she refused to take a lie detector test. The polygraph is treated as a very suspect American device in this country. It's rightly observed that its measurement of electrochemical signs of emotional tension may register the interviewee's shock at a certain question, rather than his tensely mendacious reply. And it's also true that a few people have such nerves of steel that they can bluff their way past the wires and dials. But in the hands of a trained and skilled operator, it has proved itself invaluable, certainly far better than the mere responses of a skilled interviewer. I think a polygraph might have succeeded where Helenus Milmo failed in tripping up Kim Philby. And certainly, if I were accused of something I hadn't done, I should run, not walk, to the nearest polygraph operator. Many Americans feel much the same. It is significantly suspicious that Alice didn't want her story of the night of July the 13th checked out by a measurement of her microscopically increased sweating and heart rate and breathing and electrical nervous conduction. Especially suspicious, given that she was a woman who did not balk at revealing her high-level active sex life, something many people would fear being exposed by the polygraph. Suspicion, however, is only suspicion. The police might leak to favoured reporters, "That bitch killed her children." They couldn't prove it, and the reporters couldn't print it. What they could print were stories about Alice's sexiness, stories that highlighted fears that sexual liberation and women's liberation, both great features of the times, would lead to some sort of decline and fall like that of the Roman Empire, or that God would decide to treat New York as he'd treated Sodom and Gomorrah. For it is a permanent feature of the tabloid press that the more social change allows it to increase circulation by purveying sleaze, the more hysterically it protests about that new liberty it is exploiting. It is the hypocrisy of the Sun and the News of the World that disgusts, not their obsession with the fact that human sexuality finds constant expression in all manner of ways, many of them incompatible with their practitioner's dignity or public front. The outraged police went further. They harassed Alice in her professional life. She was a secretary, and apparently a good one. But she was too notorious to retain employment under the name of Crimmins. She reverted to her maiden name to get jobs, and the police obligingly signalled to her employers that they were taking on the notorious sexpot, as the press tagged her. And then, 18 months after the murders, a witness surfaced who allowed the police to bring charges at last. Sophie Iromirsky was a middle-aged housewife from Kew Gardens. She said that on the night of July the 13th, she'd looked out of her bedroom window at 2 a.m. and seen a man, a woman, a dog and a little boy on the footpath. The man and the woman were carrying a bundle wrapped in a blanket, which the man threw into the back of the car. The woman then said, "My God, don't throw her like that." Mrs. Iromirsky thought nothing of it and prepared to go back to bed. As she pulled the window to, the hinge squeaked. The woman then said, "Somebody's seen us." That woman, Mrs. Iromirsky claimed, was Alice Crimmins. Alice's defence team demurred that Mrs. Iromirsky had a long and serious history of mental instability. The trial was the kind of grand guignol, beloved of the sensational press and hated by judges. An ex-boyfriend of Alice's, Joseph Rorich, claimed that she had confessed the murders to him. She'd killed Missy suddenly in a moment of anger and then used another boyfriend to contact hitman Vincent Colabella to eliminate little Eddie, since the child had seen his sister's murder. Alice screamed that Rorich was lying. Why he should have done so was not clear. He was a former free-spending building contractor in the process of going broke, and at this point Vincent Colabella couldn't be traced. Jerry Peering brought up some rather important evidence. There was a bureau under the window in the children's bedroom, and Peering had noticed an undisturbed film of dust on it, which could hardly have lain there if an abductor had taken two children out of the room that way. Moreover, he'd seen an empty manicotta packet at the top of Alice's dustbin, evidently the remains of the last meal she'd prepared on July the 13th, yet she claimed to have cooked veal. That second point seems an extraordinary one to have counted as crucial. If Alice was really lying about the meal, and why on earth should she? Surely she could have switched her alleged menu to veal and manicotta. Heaven knows Italian food makes a great deal of use of veal. Nevertheless, the manicotta packet would play a considerable part in her final conviction. Her defence against Peering's claims was simple. They rested entirely on his unsupported memory 2 years after the event. He'd made no notes of these observations, yet now he wanted them to support this woman's conviction. To the delight of the press, the police dragged in Alice's sex life as though it too were relevant. They had hours and hours of tapes, courtesy of Edmund, showing that life in Alice's bed was fun. They didn't have a single photograph of the window through which she alleged her children had been abducted. The judge protested rightly that Alice's sexual morals were not on trial, but the protest was hopeless. Apart from screaming at witnesses whose testimony she disputed, Alice's demeanour contributed to her general condemnation in the tabloids because she displayed hard, cold anger rather than grief. Now, that might well be interpreted as a sign in her favour. Lindy Chamberlain, the dingo baby mother, was attacked for exactly the same thing. And there is no doubt today about her innocence. In fact, a bereaved mother who finds herself falsely accused of killing her child is very likely to be utterly furious with everybody prosecuting her, and cold rage is a more rational response than conventional feminine tearfulness. But the papers and the police don't like it. Their views of women often owe more to soap opera than reality, and a woman may be convicted for the inappropriateness of her demeanour, especially if, like Alice, she's always described in the tabloids as a cocktail waitress rather than a secretary. Alice had only served drinks for 6 weeks of her life, but it suggested something calculatedly sexy. Actually, the calculation is all on the part of the pretty horrible male chauvinist employers. The indignity of dressing up respectable girls and well-preserved middle-aged women in skimpy skirts and visible frilly knickers to serve drinks to strange men is really pretty offensive. But Alice was nationally known now as a tramp, the queen of swingers, the housewife with the morals of a hamster. The jury found her guilty of the first-degree manslaughter of Missy. Alice appealed, and her appeal was upheld because two jurors had illegally visited Kew Gardens without court permission. That should have meant a simple retrial. But the prosecution meanly went to a new grand jury and got new indictments handed down, including a murder charge relating to Eddie. There were some new witnesses. Vincent Colabella, the hitman alleged by Roretch to have dispatched Eddie, turned up in prison. He denied ever having set eyes on Alice or her children, and also claimed that an assistant district attorney had promised him instant freedom if he would falsely testify having gone to the Crimmins apartment and found both children dead. Marvin Weinstein said that he and his family had left a friend's apartment in Kew Gardens at 2 a.m. on the 13th of July and might well have been the people seen by Mrs. Ireminski. Their friend Anthony King appeared to say the Weinsteins had not visited him there. Mrs. Weinstein appeared to say yes, they had. Another friend of King's appeared to say that he was a notorious liar. Mrs. Ireminski's story seemed to be getting completely mussed up in a cloud of accusations and counter-accusations. And then the New York City coroner, Dr. Milton Halpern, appeared to give evidence. One of the great forensic pathologists of all times, he testified that Missy's last meal had been macaroni, and she had died not more than 2 hours after eating it. At last, there seemed to be a scientific fact for the jury to hold on to. That two-hour interval flatly contradicted Alice's claim that she had seen the kids alive 5 hours after they had eaten. Alice was convicted of the first-degree murder of Eddie and drew a longer sentence than the one against which she had appealed. Still, she went on and on appealing, and the courts kept bouncing her case backwards and forwards, with her convictions being overturned and reinstated, and the charges increased, until at last what had originally been a 6-year sentence had expanded to 10 to 25 years. And in 1976, Alice Crimmins was denied the right to appeal any further. She was paroled the following year, more because the tabloids and the public were bored with her than for any other reason. The sexual revolution had come to stay. A Catholic DA who went on trying to keep Alice behind bars looked vindictive and sanctimonious and old-fashioned and vote-hunting. It was more fun to savage him than to go on baiting Randy Alice. She was paroled in 1977, and despite having only made things persistently worse for herself by her appeals and demands for retrials, she still maintains that she wants to be tried again to have her innocence established. Her innocence? It's possible. though I suppose unlikely. But I'm sure she suffered enough for what was probably the instantly regretted act of a momentary exasperation on the part of a harassed single parent. And I'm quite sure it didn't have a blind thing to do with her so-called immorality.